addicted, addicted to the love of a lady that is so fine. You wanna know my secret? Then you gotta get mine. Girl, you gotta get mine. Sign of a lover, Mr. Lover Man is here with a little something for ya. Nah, nah, nah. I don't think so. Let's take a long ride. Girl, don't let it go. Nah, nah, nah. I don't think so. Let's take a long ride. Girl, don't let it go.
Nah, nah, nah.
Yeah, you better get somebody.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Real Talk. My name is Mark.J.Stevens, and I will be introducing one of my good friends from the past and now future, Mr. DEE-TAILS. How are you doing, DEE-TAILS?
Hey, brother, it's so good to see you. It's been a while, man. It's been a while.
It's good to see you too, brother. I mean, we have this amazing history together, and I'm just so proud of you and what you've done and what you've achieved in life. And we need more people like you in this business, trust me.
Oh man, and it's good for me to see you keep going. Yeah, you know, we're all on our journeys, aren't we, man? All on our journey.
Right. You got that right.
It's good to be able to stay in touch and reconnect. Really good to see you.
Yes, my friend, DEE-TAILS. It's good to see you. As I said, we had a little bit of a gremlins, but we're back now. So let's keep going. Have to keep honest, you know, and let the fans know exactly what's going on. That's what I'm all about.
Yeah, man, fighting through. We don't stop fighting and pushing.
Please keep telling me about, you know, what's been happening and what's going on in your life and stuff like that.
But these things do take time, right? these things take decades, and you know, either you can move on to something else that makes life a little bit easier, or you just try and maintain your course and drive by through. And I think that's what I've been trying to do from a very young age, and especially mentally in regards to choosing a career or thinking what kind of direction I wanted to go in and why, you know. But look, man, it all stems from, I mean, look, we go back way back to, like, yeah. Wembley Arena.
Yeah. Yeah. Rick, Steve.
You'd be working at some concerts, and you know, we'd have Bobby Brown, and man, and you had the Gumby on, man. We were just there ready. And just, you know, and every time before he hits the stage, yeah, there's goosebumps. Goosebumps, and you're like, whoa, whoa. And you just can't
want to do the job no more. You want to watch the gig, you know?
That's right. Well, we kind of did.
Yeah.
We kind of did.
Most of the time.
but we're watching and we're learning and we're taking so much in. All right. And it's the same feeling that when I was part of Emanate. Mm-hmm. Yeah. When Emanate were running things on the stage, it's like before we go out there, I'm remembering those goosebumps that we felt that when we went to see those concerts, you know what I mean? And I'm going out there, and it's different because I'm going out there knowing that I'm actually feeling this, and I know what I'm giving. I know what I'm giving back, you know? And it's that sensation that I think for me transferred into film, because film just kind of drew you in through stories. And as a child, I'm not sure what age you get to when you're as a child and you understand that that's just pretend, right? And then it gets confusing because they're reenacting parts of history. And you're thinking, oh, that's how it looked. Oh, they must know that's how it looked. Yeah. Yeah, right. So you're going through that transition. But at the same time, stories just being stories would then give me these goosebumps. I'm like, oh, wow. Right at that important moment. I was watching Ghost the other day. Patrick Swayze, yeah?
Good film.
moments in that film. Looks like he's got goosebumps now. Moments in that film, and it's just about the emotional connection and someone feeling loss or someone feeling proud or that kind of thing. And you just think, oh, yeah, it just gets you there.
But that film scares me a little bit, you know.
Really?
Yeah, because of the ending. You, I'm thinking, I have to be a good person. I don't want those dark shadows coming for me at the end of when things go quiet, you know?
you see, that's the art of the storytelling. It says, well, it's trying to steer you away.
Yeah.
And it'll try and scare you away from something, you know? And if that's something's to do with a certain side of yourself that you have control over, then it's worth steering away from, you know? Whether you believe into the religious aspect or the mythological aspects of it or not, the moral is still the same in terms of how you conduct yourself and trying not to be bad while everybody else is just being bad to you because that's not what they saw in that film.
I just look at it like, you know, I've got to be a good person because I don't want that happen. Don't want that to happen to me. No, thank you. if it's real.
See, that those were the morals of the stories, you know, from the fairy tales. Yeah, goodness, and but it's also that thing where how you make that decision because of how those actions have affected others in that film or in that story. You know, that you may know more about, you know, so you know what their loss is, you know, and you're like, oh man, that's heavy. And then you can see in most films where I appreciate the bad guys always getting their comeuppance because that's that's the whole point, you know. But that whole thing just turned into me realizing that these were just adults pretending. And I'm like, that's what we do in the playground, or that's what I grew up doing, you know, and even with action figures here, they're fighting and whatever.
Exactly.
You know? Ooh. Yeah. And it was, yeah. And it was just that. It was that alone that kind of just said, well, you know, what gives you that? Does Coronation Street give you that? No, I don't want to be in Coronation Street then. You know?
Exactly. That's just not for me as well. I just can't do those kinds of things. It's too... How can I put it? It's just, it's something, it's trying to be something that I'm not sure if it really is. I've watched a few episodes of a few of those things just to sort of get an insight into how they're writing it, you know, the way they write stuff. Yeah. And I get where they're going, but not everyone's got so much dramas going in their lives. Life is pretty much easygoing most of the time.
I find those shows, like I've turned down various soaps of that ilk.
That's what I wanted to ask you. Have you been offered anything in that sort of range, and you know, what's your idea on that?
Well, in the past, I was offered some stuff for EastEnders.
Okay.
But, you know, I know what the track record is of being a person of color in one of those soaps and then trying to get work afterwards.
It's almost impossible.
So, you know, and besides that, there is just one simple fact. I hate those shows. I find those shows promoting depression, you know? And like you said, you know, not everybody's got that drama in their lives, but they're funneling that same drama that they would be feeling
all the
through
time.
Watching that stuff.
Yeah.
You know, and I like these, I like the movies that take you somewhere and lift you, take you somewhere and give you something.
For two hours, it takes you elsewhere for 2 hours of your life. And it's absolutely amazing. And you feel good going, and you feel good while you're there, and you feel good when you've left.
Yeah, even watching Tom and Jerry would be more beneficial to me than watching Coronation Street. Yeah, and that's no joke. I will sit there and I'll laugh at that. I'll laugh at old Thomas and, you know, and Jerry always having, I'll be laughing. If I'm watching EastEnders, I'm like,
you're depressed.
Which state would I rather be in? Which
exactly.
state do I have control over, you know, in terms of choosing what makes me feel a certain way?
Mm-hmm.
And that's the thing that I've always had a passion for in regards to watching certain movies.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some people can see those Marvel movies. Oh, my goodness. Some people can see those Marvel movies and just think, oh, man, that's just children's stuff. That's just whatever. Blah. But if you're following story, when you get to Tony Stark and Thanos,
yeah,
and Peter Parker, ooh,
exactly.
Goosebumps
it's
now,
deep.
Right? Goosebumps.
Yeah, I likewise. When I saw that particular scene, I mean, I felt you know, I felt for the kid because he's got this mentor that he, you know, he looked up to, and he was losing him. It's like it was happening all over again in regards to his uncle, and then now with Tony Stark. It was just absolutely beautifully shot and beautifully done.
Oh,
amazing story.
We had relationship dynamics. We had emotional dynamics without depressing anybody.
Yeah.
You know, other than you know, what was it? Was it the one before Endgame? You know, where everyone was just dropping like flies. You know, but you know, I think that's always been there, and I've always hoped to be a part of stories like that. You know, and I started out in that direction, ending up realizing that, you know what, to get an equity card to get into acting, I needed contracts. So found out, well, if I dance for people, I can get contracts. Oh, yeah, so yeah. That started that part of my career. And I got as far as auditioning for MC Hammer out in Oakland. I think we were hanging back then,
yeah,
weren't we?
Yeah, I remember.
So there was that. And then by the end of that year, I'd met the MPG while they were just hanging out backstage while Prince was on stage.
Wow.
I couldn't get into that gig. I just couldn't. but they were very eager. Like, this is before Emanate and everything. They were very eager to see me the following year. Okay. But then Prince came back, did the stadium without that setup. Mm. And so that's as close as I got. But then the following year, that's when, you know, after Hammer, after Prince, that's when Emanate happened.
Yeah,
you know, so even going as far as M&A, it was kind of like, well, I was on that treadmill of being a dancer, and some friends of mine were singers, and they just approached me and said, well, we're thinking about creating this and putting this together and whatever. And then you just go along with that train and you think, well, if there's any ounce of success, I might be able to leave a tour early, because they could say, oh no, D's in Bad Boys 48, you know, or something like that, right? You know, and that was kind of like my mindset, thinking, well, okay, my contribution to this band is a creative one, yeah, dance, choreograph, you know, styling, all that kind of stuff, do some rapping, do some writing, do some hooks and whatever, and just kind of hold my section to be able to hold and reconnect with the rest of the band, because I filtered a lot of my inspiration through them, you know, because that's what was coming at me. We love Guy, we love New Edition, we love, oh, let's do it, let's
there
do it,
you
let's
go.
Do it.
We love, yeah.
We love Jodeci, what, you know? So we're on that tip, and so anything that I did was because I knew they would like that, you know, because we all like it. Yeah. So that was kind of how I managed my way through the band and found my place, found my niche.
Yeah. The four of you were very different, though. When you look at the four of you, I always used to think, you know, look, you can clearly see the dynamics between the four of them. You all had your own thing going on. There was no doubt about it, but you as a band. I looked at you and I said, that's a band. They're tight, you know, but they've got their all four of them has their own identity. And I think that's what made M&A so great in the eyes of so many people, because the look, the style, the sound, everything was on the money.
Thank you, man. Look, when I talk about these guys, you know, I'm talking about KG, I'm talking about Cool T, I'm talking about G-Man, I'm talking about these guys were absolute legends. Definitely. Are absolute legends in my eyes.
Too, bro, don't forget yourself.
but from looking outside of the group and looking at the group and remembering what we all brought to the table, you know, it's just like, well, okay, well, I can choreograph, I can do all this kind of stuff that you want to see, and we can get real funky and all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I can do that, you know. They know that's where my strengths are. Stringing hooks together. Yeah, they weren't raps. They were very hooks, mainly hooks. And putting a style on that and growing into that. Styling the band and taking inspiration from the Temptations, Four Tops, you know, and mixing that with Jodeci, and the uniformity was paying homage to all those that came before.
Yeah.
You know, people, like, look, the pop bands before us, they will dress the same because they're following the same tradition. You know, all the bands from their day all wore the same suits and pencil neck ties,
yeah,
and all the did look. Their, you know, did their little thing. You know, we as a black community, we had the same, but we had a little bit more funk with it. You know, we didn't have punk, we had funk. You know, and that's when you had George Clinton putting some flash on it. You know, and then Earthman and Fire, cool and the gang, and then that's when style.
Even the Commodores as well.
That's when style met pop, man. Yeah. And I don't mean pop music. I mean it just popped on the screen.
Yeah.
You know, it was that beautiful. And yet it didn't diminish all the other styles that were out there. It just found its place. Yeah. You know, so we had that, and I had my inspirations from. Not that we used it so much in the styling, but I had my inspiration from watching the Hammer concerts when we worked there, you know, working how many shows? 12, 9, oh my goodness. You know,
how people you had on stage as well, Jesus.
Yes, but you see the uniformity in that, and it was more about the uniformity in colour, because some of them had different styles, so I'm paying attention to that. Then I'm looking at Jodeci, and they're kind of wearing the same kind of thing, but then they're wearing it the way they want to wear it.
Exactly.
Right? And it's just like, I get that, you know, and then you see Boyz II Men who are the traditional uniformity, right? So we had all of this going on with how we spoke and how we spoke about the industry and entertainment, and with Kay's unique voice.
Amazing.
There wasn't, you know, there hasn't been anybody since.
I don't think he was given the benefit, you know, he wasn't given the love for that vocal, because for me it's one of the best soul vocals I've ever heard.
And I've heard
a lot of soul vocals.
I've never heard anybody sing with that kind of vibrato.
Amazing tone.
Naturally.
Yeah.
And a consummate producer, writer, and knows melodies. Look, man, if he says to me, oh, D, put in that rap or put in this bit in the rap, I'm like, yeah, all right. Because you know it's on the money, right?
Yeah.
But you're doing it as mates because you're all trying to create something. And then let's create a harmony with this T. And whatever, T will come in and come on, we need just put a chain around him trying to hold him back.
So was that the dynamics in the studio? Did you all sort of like really hit the ground running from day one when you was like working in the studio and stuff?
If there's anybody out there that knows this film, The Five Heartbeats,
one of my favorite films
by Robert Townsend, if you know this movie, don't take what I'm about to say lightly. It was like we were living that movie, only it was exactly the same thing at a different time. We were encountering all kinds of things, just trying to break through, you know, and all we had at our disposal to break through was our sheer determination and talent not to care. Yeah, because one of our first showcases was in, was it the Isle of Wight or somewhere down the bottom of the UK.
Okay.
It was all the record labels there, yeah, and it's a big place, you know, and all these up and coming bands, because they're coming to show off their acts that they're going to be promoting in the new year, right? And we met who's the guy who used to manage E17?
Wasn't that Fuller?
No. It was
I forgot about that.
We love them.
Yep.
But it's kind of like their manager, right? So if you look it up or find out, the guy who managed D17, he had a band, what were they called? They were called Third Something, and there was three of them, and they wore bowler hats and things like that. And he came up to our manager, and he said, okay, yeah, because they were going on just before us. He turns around and he says, now watch a real band perform.
Wow.
Right? And we watched this band perform, and the audience were enjoying it. They just sat there and go, you know, and a guy was walking about, he sang and all this type of stuff. It was kind of like maybe if the dancers from Kylie Minogue decided to put a band on, yeah, and they had all this style, you know, subtle moves, whatever, that's what you kind of get. And it had its place, right? And then we had had 2 weeks of rehearsals, practicing, working on our set, what we were going
to
do.
Was it you guys doing that, or did you have someone else in to help you with that sort of stuff?
Oh, the label has to help, because the label is basically promoting you. So they sent us to Pineapple Studios.
Tom Watkins was the manager of E17.
Yes, Tom Watkins.
I remember him now.
You see, you know, I'm not going to say nothing, right? But, I will say it because of what he had said back then, you know, what he'd implied back then. So, I don't mind that being a name that I do forget. That was what I wanted to say. But it was this thing where he was technically right to say it. Okay. Because there had been no successful black band out there with a possible multiple album deal.
Okay.
Right. Especially vetted by Tommy Mottola in the States.
I remember that guy, one of the bosses of Sony, no?
Yeah, he used to be married to Mariah Carey. Yeah.
He had some dealings with Michael as well, apparently.
Right. Oh, well, he's huge, yeah. You know. So he basically heard that we were doing showcases to see who was gonna sign us. And I think it was Paul Berger at Columbia Records, Sony in the UK, let him know that they were going to check out this band. He heard about the band and he said, outbid everybody for this band. Yeah, we don't have a black New Kids on the Block, right? So that's where the journey was going. It was supposed to take us to the States and all that kind of stuff. And ironically, New Kids on the Block were the white version of New Edition. So I liked that. It wasn't offensive. It was just like, man, just give us the break.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so, yeah, so Tom Watkins, he had said that his band had gone out there and this was going to be our first performance. Well, our first live performance was on the word, right? But this was our first performance to the record labels to let them know what was coming. Okay. Yeah. The guys were nervous. And I said to them, you know what? We know the routine. We know it in our sleep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Those people out there, right? Act as if you couldn't care less. We are going to have the best time on that stage that they're going to feel so left out. Mm. All they're going to want to do is join in.
Cool.
Right? That's what I said. Yeah? Because when you start performing and you're looking around and you're thinking, oh, they're not really liking it. The moment you start thinking they're not really liking it, your tone just goes,
it goes down.
Yeah? And your whole vibe, right? Yeah. And there was only four of us to have each other's back.
Yeah.
And we tore that place apart.
I can imagine.
G turned into like Al Green. He was he jumped off the stage, man. And he was singing to one of the female execs that were there. You know, he was singing to her and they were all rocking and stuff like that. And The big thing about M&8 was that we knew we were being launched during the period where you knew half of those bands out there couldn't sing.
Yeah.
Right. And so everywhere you go, you know, you'll find clips of M&8 and we're doing acapellas left, right, and center. We were doing so many, I hated doing acapellas. I'm standing there looking cool, but if you look, it's just like, no, man, dude.
It's not for you.
No, I'm kidding. But what was that sometimes, right? But that was we had to bring everything that we loved to the table, and everything that we loved was huge in comparison to every other band in the UK looking at the next band as, oh, they're huge, we want to be as big as them.
Yeah,
we were in the stratosphere. You know, we were looking at legends, live and passed away. you know, to channel everything through. It was just that, you know, when you're in a moment, you know, when you're in a moment of time, when you know that you are the first to do something, so you've got a lot of responsibility.
Yeah.
And the only responsibility you got is to beam. You just have to beam. Yeah, because
shine.
If you don't, you've got no leverage later on.
Yeah.
You know, and it was interesting because at that time when we appeared, you know, when it's just like that 1 minute before midnight.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's when M&A came on the scene, 1 minute before midnight. And for the last 30 seconds, when we had disappeared, you had an influx of every version of M&A and the Eternal come through, just as the industry said, time's up. Yeah. Now we're changing it to this. Yeah. We're
going indie, alternative, yeah, whatever.
Yeah. But I'm not even talking about that. I'm talking about when they went to X Factor, because when they were doing that transition, that's when they were giving it all of that about, oh yeah, we're looking for indie bands. Really? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I got a band. Want to sign them? No. We just found someone. Yeah, we were there.
Terrible.
We were there. I was pushing your band, Sound Solo. I was pushing you and Rick.
Yeah.
We were there, and we just couldn't figure out. Saying, you're looking for... Right? Here's the stuff.
Right there. We were right there.
We're looking for this type of stuff or whatever, blah, blah, blah. No, and they weren't. They weren't. They already had the bands that they were going to bank on for that transition.
Yeah.
You know, when you look back, you see that's what it was.
Yeah, I remember it very, very well. It was a difficult time, you know. We didn't know if we actually were doing the right thing, the right style of music, to actually do it. But in our hearts, we knew it was the right style of music and what we wanted to do. But we just got like, it was like it was hitting a brick wall all the time.
Yeah, the brick wall was every time we gave the industry what it was asking for. Yeah. When you went out and did gigs, the crowds loved it. You know, it was so, how do I say, it was, I don't know if your audience has heard some of your stuff, but it was the kind of stuff that I would expect to hear on Dawson's Creek, part of that soundtrack, you know, and start moving into those realms of 30-something, really deep intellectual teen shows in America, or those romantic movies that were happening at the time, those comedies and things like that was happening. It was a no-brainer, you know, and it was difficult because this is like, well, that's what you want, we're giving it, you know. That whole transition, so there were a lot of casualties, your band included, a lot of casualties of bands trying to make it through that period, you know. And by the time we had reached our end point, you know, which came about through various conversations that were had. So I am quoting people, you know, when I'm about to say, I'm trying to think of the legal terms. All right. This is what I heard.
Yeah.
Without revealing any sources, but this is what I heard and vaguely know about. Right? So by the time we kept wondering why M&A kept being sent out to France, you know, when we had gold discs to collect in New Zealand, which we never picked up.
Ones in New Zealand?
No. No, we haven't picked up any of those. They're probably on the walls of somebody out there promoting us or something like that. We had things like that. We had an audience out in the States to start working with off the back of Bad Boys, the movie.
I remember that. I was quite proud of you guys being in that on that soundtrack. I actually bought the soundtrack because of it.
And you know what? If I wasn't on that soundtrack, I still would have bought it because of Tupac or something.
Exactly.
You know
what I mean? It was so good.
Right? And well balanced. Yeah, it was well balanced. And the Aini Kamosi. Here come the upstairs.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Wicked soundtrack.
And Diana King. Look, maybe we can reminisce in that. But yeah, we performed at Donny Iona's birthday party out in upstate New York with some of those acts and things like that, and were really well looked after. The place looked like it was out of Dallas. It had those white fences, wow. And it had a tennis court at the back, which doubled as a basketball court. Then it had a golf course, and we hijacked the golf buggies. And one of us crashed the golf buggy. I'm sure it wasn't me.
It wasn't you.
Donnie, if you watch it, wasn't me.
Exactly.
Right. So we had an audience like that, but we kept being sent back to France. Mm. And what it turns out, well, this is what I heard was happening when we were being sent out to France, mm-hmm. that ahead of the recording of the second album, the money had come through First Avenue, and First Avenue had booked to studios, and studios that we were supposed to be in. And so when we were at one studio, like Park Street Studios up in Liverpool, due to come back to use Olympia Studios mm-hmm. back in the UK, back down London. What was happening is while we were there, First Avenue was sending some of their other acts through to use up our studio
time. I remember First Avenue very well. That was that your the actual management company or record label itself?
Here's the thing, because it was G-Man who found them, mm-hmm. and at the time they had Dina Carroll.
Dina Carroll, yes.
Beautiful Dina Carroll, yes.
Whatever happened to that lady? She was amazing.
I don't know. Maybe it was the nerves. I heard that she used to get really nervous before performance and throw up and stuff like that. And I know that used to happen to Squitty Politti's lead singer as well.
Oh yeah, that was a good band. That was a very good band.
Amazing. Yeah, man.
Yeah, we're going vocal. Back now.
Oh, the tracks are still killer now.
I'm still playing. Would be still now on my iPad and Aretha Franklin. You know, absolutely amazing, amazing band. Anyhow, yeah. Let's go back to you, bro.
so that's kind of thing. So that's who they had at the time. And then when they were signing us up, we already had a track out, you know, which was the first garage tune out there, with mixed R&B vocals with this two-step beat. And Kiss FM were loving it and wanted to sign us for like, was it Steve Gervais wanted to sign us for £500?
Wow.
Right. Yeah, really, right. Jesus. You know, and you know what? Any other band would have probably said yes to that because, you know, desperate times, man. But, you know, we were already looking at First Avenue. First Avenue were looking at us. And then to get with them, they had to pull Do the Nasty from the shelves. We were called The Juice back then, J-E-U-C-E. Okay. And then had to change the name and so on and so forth. But yeah, you know, it turns out that they would get using up our studio time until the point we had a meeting with Columbia Records and they said, oh, you're in debt to us for over £1 million.
Whoa.
We don't have £1 million. Jesus. Where's £1 million? Right? So this is what I heard. Right, I keep saying that, right? So, I was there when that meeting happened. But he's, you know, and then we stepped back for a minute, you know, and he said, well, look, even if we sign up to do another album or whatever, every penny has to go into paying that off. Mm. You know, we are basically working as slaves to pay that off, and yet we haven't seen the money. Yeah. So it was just like, well, okay, well, we might as well call it a day, you know, and see if someone else will sign us. Because at the time, I know, Virgin, V2 were interested, Arista were very interested in Virgin.
Arista was a good label. They had some great artists on that label.
Yeah, but Virgin were up and coming, were storming through. And so we got out of that deal. No, we tried to get out of that deal, but then First Avenue wouldn't let us out of that contract for 6 months, just so that the heat on M&A would go cold. Yeah, after 6 months, nobody wants to pick you up again. Right, but that, as far as I'm concerned, that was deliberate. Yeah, so that's what they were doing. But also we heard that, now this is what I heard, and I will name names. I heard that Dennis Inglesby kept going back to Columbia Records, mm-hmm. saying, M&A, 10 grand for this, 20 grand for that, 10 grand, blah, blah, blah. And Columbia Records were saying, okay, here you go, here you go, here you go.
Giving them the money.
We weren't seeing any of that.
Oh, dear.
Yeah? So, we said, okay, well, we own the name. Yeah, M&A, it's us. We bought that show. They didn't, all they did was give us time and space to do that show.
Just one quick question. A lot of the fans want to know, what does M&A actually mean?
M&A, it's in the dictionary, but it's spelled E-M-A-N-T. Oh my God, I can't spell M&A. But yeah, but basically it comes from that word emanate, to emanate forth, to go forth, to come from something, come from nothing to something.
Okay.
You know, and that was our journey. And that was that we were literally nobodies. We had nothing. Yeah. And by rights, all we had was just this one little moment,
mm-hmm.
you know, and you know what? Let's just spring forward. And the thing is, we chose that name.
Yeah.
And KG abbreviated it. We chose that name because the name they were trying to give us was things like Eclipse. What about the name Eclipse? You know, they're trying to sell us on all these names just so they could own the name, right? And an eclipse was going to be like two moons next to each other, which just
no.
Yeah. And we were coming to them with things like, well, Kay mentioned this thing, said, just before you release us, why don't we release this campaign where it's just shadows of us just stood there? And they're like, who's M&A? What's that?
Mm.
You know, and then when you launch us, then you can put the pictures to the faces, to the shapes and all that kind of stuff. It's like, you know, we'll come to them with ideas like that, you know, and then the following week they'll be launching Eternal and they'll be having the shadows and the silhouettes. And we're like,
they stole your idea.
See, but the thing is, we were a fountain of them, you know. So we got to the point where we said, well, why don't you manage us? Because you manage all these things. Because back then we were like, oh wow, well, First Avenue. Why don't you manage us? And they didn't want to manage us. Yeah, from my perspective, I think they were hoping it was just going to be a quick cash cow. Yeah, okay. From a singles deal.
Mm.
Even if it was going to be a cash cow off just the one album. Technically ended up kind of being for them, right? But it was more like no, there'll be a conflict of interest and blow if we manage you, and then they go off and be production company for Eternal and then manage them, right? Yeah. So we're like oh. You know, eventually, see, there was a, you don't see, you all you saw was us looking good and we were basically performing for our future, you know. We had to kind of set up and build what we could, and all we had to do that was our reputation and our showmanship to do that.
Yeah.
You know, when you realize what's at stake, I mean, it got to the point KG didn't want to sing lead on some of those songs. He said, oh, why really? Doesn't G-Man do it or Cool T do it or whatever? He said, no, you're doing it. So it's like, oh. You know, and the thing is, when we performed live, that's the only time you ever heard us really deliver.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we used to have several routines in the bag, depending on what show it was we were going to do.
Mm-hmm.
That's how set we were, you know, but in those three variations, there was so much freedom. Do the routine when you want it. We only need to do the routine all the way through when it's for TV.
Yeah.
You know, it's, we just see all of that was all that mattered. Yeah. And all that we could really focus on. You could see, you could feel and see some of the stuff going around on the outskirts of it all, you know, going to do a road show, you know, and then the tour managers clubbing together with all these other bands and coming to us and saying, oh no, it's canceled. Yeah. We're just going to head back or whatever. And then we leave. And then the show takes place, and then they say, oh, well, we stayed, unlike M&A.
That's, I think it was terrible. It's almost like they were trying to demean you guys.
Yeah, every turn. Yeah, for a sound check. We're walking around the stage, belting it, killing it, like it ain't nothing. Yeah, mm. just making it look really ordinary, make it look really, really easy, because it was, yeah? Doing that. They'll try and mess with our sound.
Man.
Yeah? In the middle of shows, or at the start of shows, what happened in the early days is that they would mess with our sound so that the track wouldn't start, you know, and then we'd have to leave the stage. But we would refuse to leave the stage. Mm-hmm. And G would either, like in Australia, it didn't happen like that in Australia. There was a glitch in Australia. G-Man, he would stand up. He'd do a stand-up. Hilarious. Yeah, absolutely. Just out of the blue. It's just like, and then not even we worked Eddie Murphy jokes. These are just original jokes. He just dropped it, right? And then we'll tie it off with, oh, yeah, let's do a acapella. What do you want to hear? We ask them what they want to hear.
So why
we just think, and we kill it on the mic, and then eventually somebody, either a tour manager or someone, would have gotten to that booth by that time and either knocked someone out or taken over that deck to allow us to perform.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah? So why do you think they did that? Why do you think they did that?
So that it could be a story in our history today. You know, wow. Look, knowing that you're the first to do something and then never getting credit for it and things like that, what does Mando say? This is the way.
Yeah,
this is the way, you know. And those that know will kind of remember and things like that, and those that won't don't. But knowing that you're a part of that history, I mean, M&A are the biggest selling all-male black boy band of the 90s.
Exactly.
Yeah, regardless of all of what I've said about what they did to us, what they tried to do, no one can take that away other than making that's people forget. Right there. Yeah, it's like making people forget that it ever happened. That's the only way that they can do that, you know. But the damage has already been done. And the damage is a beautiful damage, because I get to fuel all of that. I get to understand what's going on as the years pass and look at things and say, oh, okay, yeah, of course it has to happen like that. And yeah, otherwise it wouldn't fit into the Five Heartbeats storyline, you know.
Perfect.
And it's an intrinsic behavioral set of things that always happen. Yeah. Yes, that we either have to fight through, or we become subdued by. You know, and when you have an ambition for something, you have an imagination for it.
Yeah.
And no one can change that. No one can take that away. You know, so on the flip side of that, it's just like, okay, cool. You know, let me see if I can get myself an acting agent. You know, I'm such a noob. I'm so green. My first audition was for Human Traffic.
Right? Was that the movie? The movie?
Yes.
Yes, yeah, I
still haven't seen it. I still haven't seen it.
You need to watch it, bro. It's a bloody good film.
I know. But I haven't watched it because I will watch it now. I will watch it soon. But I didn't watch it at the time or over the past few years or whatever, decades. It's because at the time I went in there with the expectation of being given a script, learning it, delivering it, and seeing if that happens. And I was very green because I hadn't done many auditions to get into a flow.
Yeah.
And so they gave me a script, and then they took it away and said, okay, now I want you to just kind of just wing it and just kind of chat about it. And I'm like, oh, I wasn't prepared to improv. I didn't dial into the character. I was completely lost. And I left the audition. I was thinking, oh man, that was really bad. That was a real shock for me. And then when I saw the trailer for it and I saw the brother who's playing that part of the DJ and all that, I'm like, that's what they wanted. Oh man, he's perfect. You know, he's perfect. It's
just one of those things. Yeah.
Yeah, I wasn't that actor then. The actor I am now, I wasn't that then. You know, and that was my early few steps into trying to get that moving. Mm-hmm. And then briefly after that, just filling in the gaps, I realized, well, I could try and choreograph for a few bands, you know. And usually it was for friends, so it wasn't paid, right? And then I could choreograph, or I could style. And then I moved into styling and was styling. I did some styling for Little Bow Wow, getting in some stuff for Sony, Maxwell.
Good old Maxwell, eh?
Yeah, man, legend, you know. And it's like an exhibit when he was riding high on Pimp My Ride and things like that, and just hooking him up with some Tims. Avril Lavigne, and Shania Twain when she was the biggest selling artist in the world.
Shania,
just D. We need some stuff. We need, oh yeah, what's she into? You know, and it was just like, and doing that. So that filled up that gap until that started to suffocate me a little bit. And
why?
There was a lack of appreciation and loyalty in some of the pockets that you worked in. Mm-hmm. Like, you're trying to build this thing together so we all get something from it.
Yeah.
And then after a job with some girl who creates shoes. I can't remember the name of the brand, otherwise I'd say. But you know, we set out this storyboard, how we're going to do this photo shoot. We get there, she hijacks it and says, no, it's going to be like this, it's going to be like that. And that means that from the storyboard perspective, we have to work out our lighting, where we're talking about, we're going to change that, and how that is a better selling picture than the one that you want us to do, and all that kind of stuff. And vice versa, you're just looking at that. And so that wasn't too, so like, okay. And then afterwards, you know, she was running with the images and no one got credited anywhere. And one of her own friends phoned me and said, oh, she hasn't even credited us. And it was just,
that's not good.
It was that moment. I just thought, wow, people really can just turn and make it just for themselves and about themselves.
Yeah.
You know, the lack of effort and appreciation for the time that you've given, you know, because they've come to you for your expertise. It means
nothing to them, yeah.
Yeah, you know, so things like that just forced me to tunnel vision and focus directly on one thing. It's like, well, look, I've done a bit of this, a bit of that, whatever, and I'm doing my occasional acting jobs and getting to do some character support on some big things, but I need a bit more from them. So character support on Batman Begins, character support on
that's right, because I'm sure you were in that film, weren't you?
Yeah, as a Gotham City police officer.
That's right.
There was 15 of us that were brought in at any one time to surround the actors in case Christopher Nolan wanted to give dialogue to someone to feed in. You know, so we were facilitating that. And at the same time, I was looking around thinking, is this really what I want to do? Is this really the lifestyle I want? And it wasn't until I kind of was leaning that way just because of the grand scale of it. You know, we're in Gotham City, you know, and the buildings all made and things like that. And
amazing.
An actor friend of mine, me and Andrew, just stood there watching Gary Oldman deliver his Commissioner Gordon speech about the Narrows and the prisoners escaping from Arkham, and watching his rehearsal takes, watching his performance takes, and watching what he was giving the cameraman. You know, anybody else watching it would have just said, oh, let's go on. But we're watching and I'm like, I understand, I know exactly what he's doing.
He's got amazing technique.
One minute he's running on the spot just to feed into the oxygen, and then it's an action. He's like, yeah, but and I'm like, man, this is a free masterclass I'm having here.
Yeah.
You know, and that confirmed to me that that's really what I wanted to do, because I didn't really know how to do anything else.
Mm.
You know what I mean? And because I'd spent so much time focused there on the entertainment aspect of having a career. It was just like, well, I don't need to. I mean, I've had previous jobs, man. I mean, I did the milk round and I hate milk, you know. I worked at B&Q, you know, in the garden section, so I got a bit of sunshine outside or whatever. But realistically, there was a certain point where I didn't do jobs like that anymore. You know, wasn't because the jobs were frequent in the acting, but it was because I had my savings to go on with M&A. And even before M&A, it's just that drive. It's just that drive.
Yeah.
You know, but it's that you go into that kind of or you enter that kind of race and that race is only with yourself. So you want to keep going, you want to keep going. My mantra is, if I give up today, my agent might get the call tomorrow.
Yeah.
You know, and there's too much of a passion that it's not even a choice. It's just, this is what I do. This is it. You okay. know, and from where was I going? So from those things and taking that direction from Batman Begins, that's when I started moving into doing all the little things and stuff, and did some pantos with Ian.
I just can't see you doing panto, to be honest with you. But now you're telling me it, I can see it.
Dude, you know what? I'd have to try and find a picture and send you a photo of me as Tommy. Please, yes. Cat, you know, panto for me was absolutely exhausting, exhilarating, and absolutely fulfilling.
Mm-hmm.
I played the genie of the lamp a couple of times.
Okay.
You know,
was that Aladdin?
Yeah, and Aladdin is this American genie, and he's cool and sassy and things like that. So I did that a couple of years, and then they were talking about Dick Whittington, about this guy from up north who comes down to London seeking his fame and walking on gold cobbled streets and things, only to find that it ain't like that. You know,
sounds like the music industry.
Hey. so he befriends a cat, and he falls in love with the mayor's daughter and helps see off an evil baron, and they get married, and it's a happy ending. But my cat character, halfway through, reveals that he can speak.
Okay.
You know, and when he speaks, he sounds a lot like Donkey from Shrek. You know, and he's got this afro, and he's got white ears here, and he's looking around, you know, and his face is painted black and white with a white whisker thing up here. And I really got to work with Ian Adams, who's the director on that, and the team that we had, Anthony, and it was just an incredible moment where, how do we create this cat? Because we want to base it around you. And I'm like, yeah, well, I'm not going to be dressed up like the cat from like in Cats or something, man, because there isn't much of me, and I ain't getting on stage looking with my skinny butt, right? So it was, you know, we kind of worked out how we were going to design the outfit and things like that. And then it was just, one, I love ridiculous comedy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And panto is absolutely ridiculous, right? And secondly, knowing that it's for families and it's predominantly for children, the entertainment value and the return
is immense.
I can't really put that into words. I mean, I turn up an hour before everybody else to start painting my face. I'm the first one in and the last one to leave. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So predominantly probably being the only one of the few people that get the least amount of sleep. Right. And we have two shows a day. And sometimes I'll be putting that face on, and then they open the door, you know, and then you can hear all the kids. I'm like, yeah.
I'm like,
they're so excited. And you can hear them saying certain things and things like that, you know. And then on top of that, to fuel me, to give me a bit more fuel on some of those low days, you know, where you're finding energy from nowhere. It's just like, yeah, what if this is the show where George Lucas and Spielberg come and watch with their kids?
Exactly. Yeah.
I've got to dig deep. And having that mantra in my head helped me give 100% every single time, no matter how exhausted I was, you know, and also learning the art of comedy, which I remember this comedian, he got really, really nervous. He got really scared. He said he didn't want to be on the set. He didn't want to be on stage at the same time as the cat, because the cat would pull focus. Mm-hmm. And then I know that the director had tried to speak to him and said, oh, no, it's not like that. You know, and he was a bit sheepish. He didn't want to say anything to me or anything like that. And I said to him, dude, that's not what happens. You have to understand, yeah, I'm not here to steal the show. I'm here to help tell the story, right?
That's what it's
about. So when you're telling a gag, Yeah. If they're watching me when you're telling this gag, if I find it funny, they're going to find it funny.
Exactly.
You have to find a way to funnel that whole joyous aspect into what you're giving them. And
find
so,
balance.
Yeah. And the reaction that you want from the audience is helped by the reaction from those of you, from those people on stage. Excuse me. And yeah, those people on stage. And so if you say something stupid and someone looks at you like, they're selling that you've just said something really stupid. Yeah. And with the cat, I could always funnel that through because he was a little bit naive as well. I had to play him that. So you'd have Dick Whittington stood there and you have Alice stood there and looking in each other's eyes, you know, it's so romantic. And I haven't got a clue what's going on. You know, and that sells that whole thing. So it's all about giving that. And I learned so much. And I didn't even know at the time that what I was doing was classed as creature performing or creature performance. And subsequently, while doing that, I'd met Brian Herring, who was working on a few of those pantos, who was pushing his panto scripts forward and things like that, who ended up being a consultant on The Force Awakens.
Wow. All right. We're going to take a
break.
That's
the journey. That's a long journey.
That's another story. I want to take a break because there's a little commercial aspect to this real talk. So we're going to take a break and then we'll be right back with details and talking about life in general. Bye for now.